And it's a wonderful privilege to be able to address you again this morning. And I want to speak on a little message on sacrificial love. And I want to be addressing it more to the husbands, to the men. We want to be looking at the word on sacrificial love. Paul, the great apostle and the great prophet, the husband of the first church age, brought out the mystery. And we want to be looking at that thought. Now, Brother Branham says that God in the beginning desired fellowship. One of God's great attributes was to desire fellowship. God yearns for fellowship. God being eternal, existing with his thoughts, yet with a great desire to give expression to himself. That expression from the invisible creation to a physical creation and then into a new creation to bring many sons to himself. Amen. So we see that God, in his great mind, from the invisible creation to the physical creation and then to the new creation, the great purpose was to give expression and to have fellowship with His creation. The very heart purpose of the creation was fellowship, and in His divine counsel He purposed to establish the kingdom in the hearts of His people. And that's why God coming to pour Himself out so that He can become the all in all, and God could give full expression in this end time. We find the very life of God was in the physical creation. He breathed upon Adam, and Adam became a non-perishable soul. And so we see that God's great purpose and God's great plan was to give that expression, and in that expression was to come and share, that we can share His life with His new creation. And it's all by done by His great divine love. And so we see that God, the great creator, is our husband. And we see God being the creator, being our husband, He came to provide. God is a provider. So before Adam even came on the earth, God provided everything for Adam. He provided the marine life. He provided the botany life. He provided the animal life. He provided the human life. Everything was there for Adam. So we see that God, as the husband, is the provider. Not only is God the provider, but God is also the protector. Amen. So we see that the entire Bible, or the entire Word of God, evolves around marriage. The Creator is your husband. And we see that in the book of Revelation 7:19-17, it says, the marriage of the Lamb has come, and His wife has made herself ready. So there is a husband and wife relationship between God and His creation. And so we find in Ephesians chapter 5, the Bible says, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church. So we see that the love that God brings, and we find Paul in Ephesians brings out two headships, the headship of Christ and the headship of the man. And he says, as Christ so loved the church and gave Himself for it, so ought men to love their wives. So the love that God brings to the man, it is not just filial love, but it's absolutely sacrificial love. Amen. To love her so much that you will be able even to be prepared to die for her. Amen. So God's love was not in the air. God loves wasn't just by words, but God came to demonstrate His love. And Calvary was an expression of His love. Amen. So we find that God wrote our names in the Lamb's Book of Life, but Calvary came to express God's love. And God identifies that same sacrificial love. As He loves the church, so also should men love their wives. Amen. So we're looking at sacrificial love. Galatians 3 says, husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them. Amen. We see in the scripture the emphasis is on the man loving his wife, because the woman is the love part of the man. So God took him from, so Brother Benham says, when God designed His creation, God was a lover. He says God was cooing over His creation. So the creation was, when God saw the botany life come forth, it was like a love affair between God and His creation. So the creation was formed by love. Amen. So we see the first woman was a response to man's loneliness. She was made to fill the emotional need of the man, but for her to supply that need, she needs love. Amen. So we find that she's got to supply that emotional need of the man, but for her to supply that need, she needs the love from the man. Amen. That love that Paul speaks about is not based on sexual love, but it's a deeper revelation, but it's absolutely an expression from the man to really supply that need that will be able to make it easy for her to subject and submit herself to that man. Amen. No emotion is more needed and more talked about and yet less understood than love. Amen. There is God's love, which is perfect love, which is pure, which is called agape love. Then there is filial love. Then it drops down to lustful love. Then it goes unto ungodly, and then it goes down to filth. But Paul comes in Ephesians and he brings out sacrificial love. Amen. A man standing in the court one day said, I love my wife so much, I could not see her leave me, so I killed her. He wasn't loving his wife. That was jealous love. Amen. But we're not talking about jealous love or just being infatuated or just lustful love or just filial love, but we're looking at sacrificial love. Loving her so much that you'll be able to even die for her. As when Brother Branham came to us, the hand in marriage for his wife, he says, I promise you, I will work my hands off just to make her happy. I will do anything I can because I love her and that's why I've chosen her. Amen. Love is to the marriage what a shock absorber is to a vehicle. Amen. If there's no love, there's no shock absorbers. Amen. It is absolutely, it cushions the rough spots of life. Amen. That's why Brother Manham says, a church can have all the gifts, but it's not governed by love, it won't benefit that church. Give me a church full of love and I can tell and show you a church full of power. Amen. Brother Branham says, love is the mainspring of a church. Amen. Everybody agrees that love is a feeling, but where it comes from or how it's inspired has many questions. Love is the motivator that causes action, and the best way it is described, it is in God's word. Love is kind, love is patient, love is humble, love is generous, love is polite, love is sincere, love is trusting, love is gracious, and love is unselfish. Amen. Amen. Can we say praise the Lord? Amen. The moment you marry your wife, you've got to love her just the way she is. Not only love her, but love everybody that she loves. And every woman loves her mom, she loves her dad, she loves her brothers and sisters. And you have to love them just the same way as you love her. Amen. Amen. Because they are a part of her. Amen. And so many times, because when grievance comes in the marriage, it is your family and my family. And so the family is pulled into our relationship. But the moment we love our wife unconditionally and we love her regardless, then we love everybody that she loves. Amen. And that's why we should never try to hurt our wives, to bring up her family into our marriage. Amen. Your dad and your mom and your family, but to respect them and love them. Amen. Because by loving them is loving her. Amen. Can we say praise the Lord? Amen. That's why Brother Branham says, I would rather let you love, God would rather let you love his children than love him. Amen. If a man is upset with you, maybe in the church, but if you can love his children, you'll conquer that man. And that's the same with God. Flowers to a man may be a waste, but to a woman it's meaningful. Love gives expression. Amen. That's why universally around the continent, around the world, flowers is meaningful to the woman. It gives expression. Amen. Women have a greater need to be loved. As one woman said, without love, I have no life. Amen. And that love that the woman needs, it's the fuel that energizes the woman. It is the mainspring of her life. And that love is expressed through words, through flowers. A hug to a woman is more meaningful than sexual expression. Kindness and just holding her and just telling her how much you love her, how much you appreciate her, it's meaningful to her because she lives by words. Amen. Amen. The messenger said, when a man loves a woman and marries her, her because she's just pretty, there'll be an end to that. Amen. That's why young men should not be looking for Miss Perfect Physique, but to look for Miss Perfect Will. Amen. The one that is a part of you, no matter how she looks from the outside, you love the person on the inside. Amen. The Bible says Adam slept and God woke him up. Adam wasn't looking for a wife. Adam wasn't looking. We find God was the one who placed Adam to a deep sleep. And God was the one who woke him up again. And God was the one who introduced the woman back to the man. God was the first surgeon. God was the first marriage officer. And God was the first evangelist when man fell. Amen. He says, when a man loves a woman and marries her because she's just pretty, there'll be an end to that. But when a man finds a woman that he loves, he don't know why. He doesn't know why, but he just loves her. He can't explain why he loves this woman, but he loves her. But he loves her and he finds her, and she finds a man that she loves, no matter what he looks like, he loves her. And she loves him. That's an eternal mate in glory. Death, nothing else can ever separate them. Not even death can separate your true partner from you. On the other side, you will spring forth again in newness of life. Can we say praise the Lord? Hallelujah. Because they are from eternity and step out into space of time and will return back to eternity. Eternity has dropped down in a body called time. Then it goes right back into eternity again. It cannot perish. Amen. Hallelujah. So your wife is precious. Amen. A woman that's beautiful, that beauty will fade away just as sure. You just give it a few years. Amen. She might have an accident. She might lose her eye. She might develop cancer. She might, anything might happen to her body. But you're going to love her regardless because you did not marry the body. Amen. You married the person on the inside. There was something on the inside, a character on the inside that you were attracted to. It was the deep calling to the deep, and there was a deep responding to it. Amen. Husbands are commanded to love their wives. We see it not as an option, but it's a command by God. Amen. How does God define love? In the original Greek word in the Bible, it's two words which is used to describe agape and filial. Filial can be best described as an affection. It involves emotions. When, for example, Jesus wept at the grave of Lazarus, the people said, "See how he loved him." Agape love is unconditional love. It's sovereign love. The Bible says he loved us before we even loved him. So God's love is elective love. Brother Branham says his great purpose is in his love. The cloudy skies and the stormy skies is not a sign of God's disapproval to you. Neither are the bright skies and the sunny skies a sign of his approval. But his approval is in the beloved. His love is elective. He loves you regardless of your physical weakness. Amen. And Paul brings out the love of the male or the man is connected with God's love. Sacrificial love. Amen. We find both in Ephesians and Colossians chapter 3, husbands are told to love their wives as an act to meet their needs materially, physically, socially, a responsibility for her total welfare. Amen. That's why a woman can never make a decision to go and work on her own. Unless her husband asks her to go and do that. Amen. No woman can say, "Well, you know, you're not giving me enough groceries money. You're not giving me enough clothing money. I'm going to do my own thing." She can only go out there under the blessing of her husband. And that it must be a specific need that she has. Amen. Amen. That's why a headless woman has got no leadership. Amen. Has got no direction. A headless church has got no direction. And there's no vision because there's no leadership. And if there's no vision, the people perish. And there's no vision, no direction in the family, that family perishes. That's what the husband, the man should take his stand, and as his role, he's responsible for the welfare of his family. Amen. That is the calling of the man, whether he feels it or likes it or not. Amen. That is his calling.
That's right. Amen.
The moment he took her and he says, "Honey, I love you. I want you to spend your life with me." He's taken on a responsibility.
Amen.
And that's why Brother Branham says marriage in all spheres is a responsibility.
Amen.
Amen. As husbands, in Romans chapter 5, God demonstrates his own love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Amen.
Amen. And that's why while people are yet sinners, we should still love them. Because Christ loved us while we were yet sinners. And while your family and your loved ones are still sinners, you've got to love them regardless. Can we say praise the Lord? Whether your mother is a Catholic or an Anglican or a Baptist, that's still your mom and dad. The Bible did not say love your Christian mother and your Christian father. But love your mother and your father. It's a commandment with a divine promise. Because mom and dad was used by God. God used their bodies to process you out in the end time. Amen. And the Bible says if you honor your mother and father, your days will be long on the earth. And you'll be blessed. You can go on so many diet tablets and so many Sportrum and Swiss Guard and all the vitamin tablets come on the market. The only thing is honor your mother, your father. Your life will be long on earth. God will bless you. God will be with you. And that's why when I look at Brother Lonnie Jenkins and all the sacrifices coming to the continent of Africa, around the world, doing things for the believers unselfishly, I believe that same blessing will come upon his sons. Come upon this church, come upon whatever is done, God will bless it again via his children.
Amen.
Can we say praise the Lord?
Amen.
Brother Branham says, as the bad follows your children, so the good also follows your children.
Right.
Can we say praise the Lord?
Amen.
And that's why it is good to love, because love keeps you young.
Amen.
Love keeps you clean on the inside.
Yeah, right.
And that's why Brother Branham says, by the grace of God, he says, God is my witness. I've never had a bad feeling against anybody.
Amen.
He was an end time prophet, an example seed, saying, I never had a bad feeling towards anybody. And I believe we got to come to that same position.
Amen.
Where we can love everybody regardless. Sinner or saint.
Amen.
Whether people like you or not, you love them regardless.
Amen.
Amen. That's when perfect love comes in the church. And Brother Branham says, when that perfect love comes in the church, he says, you don't even have to lay hands upon the sick. The sick will be healed. The dead will be raised. God will be just operating in the church. Amen. And if a home is love controlled and love motivated, Satan can never, never destroy that marriage. Can we say praise the Lord? As husbands, we do not have to experience the feeling of affection before we act lovingly towards our wives. Amen. It is unconditionally. Lover regardless. Amen. Whether she talks a lot, whether she's slow, whether she's melancholy, whether she's phlegmatic, whether she's choleric, whether she's sanguine, no matter what she is, you love her regardless. Can we say praise the Lord? But as we act, So the feeling of love will follow. That means if you want to fall in love all over again, you have to start acting lovingly towards your wife. Amen. And that's what Brother Branham says. We should never let the honeymoon feeling cease out of our life. And I spoken to my church one time and speaking about there is a kneecap session that you should have. Take two chairs. Put a chair in front and your wife facing one another. Let a knee touch your knees and look into her eyes. That is called a kneecap session. As when you can put her knees next to your knees, look in her eyes, hold her hand, and just talk to her. And I believe that's wonderful therapy. Wonderful therapy just to say, honey, I love you, I appreciate you. Thank you for what you mean to me. And she says, you know, I love you and appreciate you for being a man. You are the most handsome man that God has given me. Express that. Can we say praise the Lord? You should tell everybody, my husband is the most handsome husband. And my wife is the most prettiest woman. Because God has given you the best. Can we say praise the Lord? I want to read in one of the quotes as we will continue on. It's on page 10 of the quote book that I made. It's on quote number 2. Brother Branham says here, he says, just like you say, you know, you men, if you're the right kind of husband, there is no woman in the world that you love like your wife. There might be other women, might be more fair. There might be women that would be more prettier and so forth. But something, if you really love your wife, there's something in there that you don't notice what she looks like. You love her and you don't know why, but you love her. Amen. Can we say praise the Lord? Amen. Hallelujah. Let me just read another quote as we continue on. Amen. And if you don't truly love your wife better than any other woman in the world, she's not yet. There's something wrong. Brother Branham says, if you don't truly love your wife better than any other woman in the world, she's not yet. There is something wrong. And if you don't love your husband, if you trifle on him and don't live the right kind of life, there's something wrong. That's right. She will not. They will not be there. So in the resurrection, you might married him, you're living honorable to him, that's fine. I appreciate that. You should do that as a lady for your children and you men to your wives. You should do that, live honorably. Amen. Amen. Can we say praise the Lord? Praise the Lord. Ephesians chapter 5 spells out clearly as a man must have love for his wife as Christ loved the church. Paul brings out two headships as Christ so ought men. That love is the standard. Amen. This implies that he must put her first. Amen. He must build her up. He must protect her both physically and emotionally. And he must show her understanding and he must provide leadership. Amen. He's the high priest of the home. He's the angel at home. He's the pastor at home. And he's got to provide that leadership. Amen. He must not be an arrogant military slave driver. But he's got to lead by example. Amen. He must live a life so much before God that he will make it easy for her to subject herself under that headship. Can we say praise the Lord? And in Philippians chapter 2 says, we must consider the needs of others more important than our own needs. Just as Christ did. When a man puts his needs before his own, he's loving his wife the way God intended him to love her. Amen. I love her. And that's why Brother Benham says, I love my wife so much, I can place her, press her right through me. He says, multiply that by 100 times. He says, you'll only come to a speck, a drop of God's love.
Amen.
Amen. The prophet speaks again in the message called The Way to Have Fellowship. That's what makes a mother would die for a baby. Why? That's what makes a father would give his life for his wife. A husband, a true husband, would give his life for his wife. Why? Because Christ gave his life for the church. Amen.
Amen.
Do your life love your wife so much today that you can say, I would even prepare to surrender and die for her? That's what God speaks in his word.
Amen.
Amen. It's a strain in you because Christ gave his life for the church, his wife. It's a strain in you, and it makes a mother dash through a burning fire, not thinking about her own self, and her hair on fire, clothes on fire, to grab a baby and run out with it. Why? It is a love. It is a love of a parent. And God is the first original parent. And there is where the strain comes from, because woman gave birth to the child. And that's the reason God has come down to manifest in the flesh. He went to the very flames, the hottest of suffering, that he might bring us into fellowship with him. Taking no thought of his own, not my will, but thy will be done.
Amen.
He literally went to hell to take us to heaven. Amen. He became sin that you might be called the very righteousness of God being in Christ.
Amen.
He drank the bitter cup that you might drink the cup of blessing. He wore the crown of thorns that you might wear the crown of righteousness.
Amen.
He took your place. He became sin that you might be crowned. He was the conqueror, but you are more than a conqueror.
Amen.
Glory be to God. In Proverbs 31, it says, it describes a wife of a noble character. One reason that she is such a blessed woman is because her husband praises her. We read Proverbs 31, it says, her husband praises her. And that's why it is most important for a man always to praise his wife. Amen. Praise her food, praise whatever she does, praise her. She needs that more than sexual expression. Can we say praise the Lord? Every word of praise and appreciation builds up. Never compare your wife with another woman. Never compare with another sister. No matter how good that sister cooks, never compare her with somebody else. She is special to you. Amen. Can we say praise the Lord? Amen. Every word of praise and appreciation builds up. Every word of criticism breaks it down, because she lives by words. When a man constantly picks on his wife, finding fault with her, she will come to a conclusion that she's a failure as a wife. And she will literally have a nervous breakdown, and the hairs will start falling out. Because the husband becomes a military dictator and puts upon her words of failure upon her. But I want to encourage you today, lift her up.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Brother Branham says, God loved us so much, God came to lift us up.
Right.
He has given us the word of infallibility.
Yeah.
He said, the word is in your mouth, you can speak it, I will perform it. That is my promise to you. I will never fail.
Amen.
Amen. He has not come, Brother Manham says on page 64 of the Church Age book, he hasn't come to bring us fear or failure. But he's come to bring us power, peace. And he's given us his word. We must speak it. He will perform it. That's his promise to us.
Amen.
Hallelujah. When a man constantly picks on her, finding fault with her, she will come to a conclusion that she's a failure as a wife, and she will act like one. However, when you praise her, when you tell her how much you appreciate her, reminding her of her strengths, it will bring the best that's within her, give her that recognition.
That's right.
Amen. You have to enjoy talking to her as much as you enjoy talking to her during your courtship.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You've got to not give her 10 commandments. Thou shalt not do this. Thou shalt have my clothes ready. Thou shalt, thou shalt, thou shalt. That 10 is wonderful. But if it's not governed with the 11th commandment, it can destroy. That's why the 10 is all wrapped up in the 11th commandment. Can we say praise the Lord? You have to learn to appreciate, and you've got to learn to express that appreciation. God just never just says, well, I love you and that's finished. He came to express his love. Amen. And I can tell my wife in the morning, I love you and I appreciate you. She'll like to hear it again at 10 o'clock. If she can get it 5 times or 6 times a day, a woman lives by those words. They want to hear from you every day that you love them.
Amen.
It's meaningful to them. You might say, I told you yesterday, so why ask me again? It seems like you don't trust me. But it's meaningful to the woman. Can we say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Amen. We find Jesus healed 10 lepers and only one came back to say thank you. Jesus appreciated that thank you. And that's why it's good to come to church and just say thank you. Thank you for the good wife. Thank you for my husband. Thank you for a good pastor. Thank you for good deacons. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. God appreciates the thank you. Amen. And that's why thank you should be part of our lives. We should raise our kids up. Whatever they receive, say thank you. Nothing must just be for granted, but it's got to be with appreciation, because God desires to hear from us thank you. Because Jesus turned around and says, I've healed 10. And only one came back to say thank you. Where's the others? If the God of heaven appreciates the thanks, what about us? Amen. That's why it's times that you must be able to come and say, thank you, Pastor, for a good message. Or the church come together, Pastor, once a year. Let's all club together. Let's buy our pastor a nice suit. Let us buy his wife a nice dress. And let us do something for him and say, thank you.
Amen.
Thank you is a great word. Because the God of heaven appreciates a thank you.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you for managing the home. Thank you for ironing your clothes and the food and raising the children. Your appreciation gives her the fulfillment, the energy, the fuel to fulfill her task. Amen. Aren't you happy this morning, brother, sister? I'm glad, brother, sister, the moment you find out your position as a man, it's a wonderful position.
Amen.
Amen. When I have visitors in my homecoming, or maybe we have 10 or 20 people, I would never go to bed and say, well, you know, that's my wife's duty to wash up the dishes. I feel she's just a human being as I am. She's cooked the food for the whole day. We entertain 10 people. I'm not going to leave it with the dishes. I'm going to stay behind until everything is cleaned up. And I believe by sharing with her and helping her, it shows that you love her. She's not a slave. She's not an object of sexual object. She is your love part.
Amen.
Amen. Thank her for managing the children. Thank her for doing things. Brother Branham says here again, a good woman is a jewel in a man's crown. Said the wisest man on the earth, a man ought to honor a good woman, but an evil one is water in his blood, and his blood is his life. You men that's got good wives, you don't know how you ought to thank God for a good wife.
Amen.
Amen. Thank God every day for a good wife. For if God could give a man anything better for an helpmate, he had done it. But a woman is the best helpmate that God could give to a man. Amen. Besides salvation. Let's thank God this morning for good wives. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Tell her how much you admire her, expressing admiration for a taste of clothes. Welcoming you home at night after a long day. Express it.
Amen.
Amen. Tell her how much you appreciate her. Amen. I just want to read just another quote here. On page 9, and it's paragraph 4. How can you have faith in your wife if you don't love her? That's filial. How about a gaper to God? How can it be if you don't love God? If you said you love your wife and never tell her about it, you never set her down and make love to her, express it to her, kiss her, hug her, and tell her she's the best cook in the country. And all the things that you know and how pretty she is and how much you love her, if you don't do that, she will never know it. That's the way I know you do love her. You express it. That's the way we do to God. We love him and we tell him we love him. We sit down and we adore him. And that's why we worship him. Love drives us to that. Amen. I thank God today for the message of the hour. It's no more on Sunset Mountain. It's no more on Sabino Canyon. It's no more on the computer. It's no more on the books. It's no more on the tapes. It's coming home now. Brother Branham said, there's many women. There's only one woman that goes home with me. Your revelation has got to go home with you. Amen. Amen. Every man gets a wife he deserves, for she becomes what he makes her. If you constantly run her down, you'll end up with a disgraceful wife. If you constantly build her up, you'll have a wife of a noble character. Proverbs 12:4 says, a wife of a noble character is a husband's crown, but a disgraceful wife is a decay to his bones. The choice is yours. Is what kind of a person your wife will develop into, it is in your hands. Can we say praise the Lord?
Amen.
Amen. A woman needs protection. It describes her as a weaker vessel. This protection is not only physically, but it's also emotionally. Protecting her from the difficult decisions, from fatigue, from time and pressure, the family, the children, the outside world, taking all the fears and cares upon you. That's what the Bible says. Cast all your cares upon him. He cares for you. And that's the same way women should be able to do. Cast all her cares and her fears upon her husband. I'll take care of your fears. I don't want you to worry about anything. I'll take care of it. It's not your job to worry about the mortgage bond. It's not your job to worry about the lights and the rent and the water. That's my decision. I have chosen you. I am the leader. I am the pastor of the home. That's my, I don't want you to scratch your head up about all those things. That's my duty as a husband.
Amen.
I want you just to serve me, raise my children, and love me. But I'll take care of everything. All your fears and all your cares, don't worry about that.
Amen.
It's my cares. Your fears is my fears. Your cares is my cares. Can we say praise the Lord?
Amen.
Understanding her. In 1 Peter 3:7, it says, dwell with your wives according to knowledge. Amen. Understanding her. The same way God in the end time has come, he has come to dwell with his bride according to knowledge. God has come to absolutely come to sow his seed in his bride. We are known as we were known. Because God has come to dwell with his wife according to knowledge. The Bible opens with a pregnant woman, and the Bible will close with the woman that's pregnant. The Lamb's wife. Can we say praise the Lord? It is important to understand how she functions mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. To be sensitive to her needs, it means learning to express love in her language. There's a language of love. Love means tenderness and love means gentleness. Amen. Above all, he needs to be the spiritual leader in the home to lead and to guide. He becomes the priest and he becomes the intercessor. Amen. Intercedes for the family. Intercedes for the children. Brother Branham says, and you women that take another man in your arm, you married the mole that were taken from. Remember, when you act like a man, you out of your place. And when a man begins to get sissy, too baby and this and that and the other, he's out of his place. His boss, his ruler. Now, I don't mean a floor mat. I said a ruler, a helpmate. Not kick a woman around. No real gentleman will beat his wife. No real godly man will smack his wife. No real godly man will run her down. Because she's your flower. Amen. If you talk about your wife to your mother or to your family, you're actually talking about yourself. Amen. But to be a helpmate, a part of him, she's sweet and kind and tender. You should lead her around sweetly because she's a part of you. You go mistreating her, then you are mistreating yourself. And any man mentally right won't not do that. If you are mentally right, you will never do that. But thank God, brother, sister, we can become sane by the message of this hour. The mind of God has made us sane. Anything outside of this message, you are insane. There's more people insane outside the mental institution. Because the whole generation is insane. The only thing that's sane is the word of God that has come by the prophet of the hour. Amen. Hallelujah. The Bible says the two shall become one. When two becomes one, it speaks of peace. But if one becomes two, it's warfare. But if two becomes one, that's peace. And that's why you've got to function. The trainer and the horse has got to have completely one mind.
Amen.
The two are one, whether you like it or not. So everything, every time you run it down, you run yourself down.
Amen.
Amen. Every time you build her up, you build yourself up.
Amen.
Every time you love her, you love yourself. For what man ever hateth his own flesh, but nourish it and cherish it as the Lord the church. The ingredients is submission and love. That's God's standard. And it's to yield to God's word unconditionally. And the Holy Spirit comes into your temperament. And the Holy Ghost comes and transforms that temperament. The basic needs of the woman, she needs to know and be known by you. Can we say praise the Lord? The Bible says we shall be known as we were known. We were known by God. But in the end time, this message comes and brings our origin back to us. That's why we can have faith in our destiny, because our origin has been portrayed in this end time. Hallelujah. She needs encouragement. She needs praise. She needs to know that you really need her. Not only to say, I love you, but also to say, I need you. Can we say, praise the Lord? Amen. When the roles are crossed, the children behold wrong images, and it will influence their entire life. Stay with the role God has made you. Be happy to be a woman. And be proud to be a husband. As the husband submits to the authority of Jesus Christ, and the wife submits to that authority in a husband, that's a great union. That's the perfect picture. A woman has got no rights, but she's got privileges. And her privileges of being a wife, that is her right. Amen. Can we say praise the Lord? We must remember that men act and women react. They will respond to the way the husband behaves. We act and they react. Brother Branham says here in a message, Thinking Man's Filter, Oh, for the grace of God that has given us an understanding of such great mysteries. As Paul spoke here further down in Ephesians chapter 5, speaking of husbands and wives, he said, this is a mystery. How the woman should be in respects to their husband. Even the second place, I believe it is, in the entire Bible, that reverence was ever spoken to. He said, woman seeing that she reverence her husband, then a husband ought to live such a life before his wife that his wife could reverence him as a son of God. If he doesn't live that kind of a life well, then of course she wouldn't reverence him. Of course she knows what he's made of. But when it is a man that is reverent and clean with his wife and before his family, a real servant of God, then the woman, children, all should respect and reverence that servant of God. Amen. Can we say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Both must have all. Both must give all in the marriage to reap the blessings of it. And to see that blessing come into the children. Amen. Your children is watching you. And the way you react and the way you act, it's images you present to the kids. And that's why I believe that mom and dad should never argue before the children. There should be no fussing and fuming before the children. But it always should be images presented before them. Amen. Brother Branham says marriage is honorable and it should be entered into prayerfully and reverently, and genuine love for that woman will bind you together forever. What you bind on earth, I'll bind in heaven. When you walk down the street yonder, she may get old and gray and wrinkled, but that same love that you had for her when she was young and beautiful, you'll still have it. Amen. You may get stoop shoulders and bald and headed and wrinkled face and everything else, but she will love you just like you did when you stood with your white shoulders and your curly hair. If it's really God, you're looking for the time when you cross the river yonder and when you spring back again to young man and young woman again. That's God's eternal promise. That's thus say the Lord, brother, sister. Praise his wonderful name. She's part of you. Amen. Brother Branham says in God of the Evil Age, he says, God, when Christ hang on Calvary, God made you pay for your own sins in that body. Your wife was part of you in that body. Amen. And when you married her, you redeemed her. You become an amateur redeemer. Whatever God is, that is what we are. If God is a redeemer, we are redeemers. If God is a creator, we are amateur creators. What was Abram doing? He was redeeming Lot. What was Joseph doing? He was redeeming his brothers. We are redeemers. And you are a redeemer because you redeem your part back to yourself again. Amen. Marriage starts with excitement and bliss, and it takes a plunge when all that is faded. Then it takes the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge to bring it back again. And that's why Brother Branham says, we should never, never, never let the honeymoon feeling cease. It's always, you know, when it's the man's, or the man needs a shirt, or he needs maybe a fishing rod, then there's always money. But when it's for the woman, there's always no money. But I believe that a man, no matter how selfish he might be, I believe when the woman finds her position, she can pull out of him whatever she needs. Amen. The woman is so powerful in the hands of God that she can actually take that man and have him in her hands like clay. And now what? No matter how many stingy spirits might be with him, she loosens all those spirits. Amen. The key is in her hands. Can we say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Amen. I want to read another quote again. Brother Benham says, and we're talking about a man losing these affections for their wives and don't love them as they did when they were sweethearts. Shame on you. You ought to do that. She's always going to be your sweetheart. Absolutely. That's the part that should be, and you should treat her like that. Oh, never let that little honeymoon cease, because it isn't going in to heaven, going to be just perfect like one day. That's right. Looks like some woman ought to say amen to that, don't it? Never let me hear you're always bawling woman out and talking like, Sister Hickerson, why didn't you say something, or somebody back there? Thank you, Sister Cox. That's very good. That's for you, wherever you are. All right, yes, sir. We should never, never forget to honor each other. Always be sweethearts and never let that honeymoon feeling cease. If it's gone today, I want to encourage you, restore it back again. If the honeymoon feeling has left you, the cares of life is coming, there's time for restoration again. Marriage is of God. There are two golden expressions that every couple should maintain through their marriage. And those expressions is, I am sorry and I love you. Those two expressions should always be part of your marriage, because every one of us are going to make mistakes. You will sin against your partner many times, but you must be willingly to say and face up to your mistakes and say, honey, I am sorry. I had to many times say to my wife, I am sorry. I had to identify my own mistakes. I'm not telling you, brother, sister, well, I always had a perfect marriage. I'll be a biggest deceiver telling you that. But we went through schools of life, and until God, by His grace, by the Word of God, just we found our positions. I was many times a military dictator. But by the grace of God, by the Word of God, and by the message of this hour, it has literally came to find my place, that to know that my wife is not a sexual object, but she's a part of me. And I thank God I could repent. Thank God I could identify my own mistakes in my own life, in my own areas. And by identifying my mistakes and saying sorry, God could give me grace. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. To say, I'm sorry and forgive you, because faith, Brother Branham says, is based on forgiveness. One time a couple came to a marriage counselor. The wife tearfully said, my husband has never apologized to me in 23 years we were married. The counselor asked her, why have you never apologized? His reply was, I did not think it was manly for me to apologize, because my father never apologized to my mother. Amen. But I think it's manly to apologize. I think it's manly to say, I was wrong. It is manly to say, I made mistakes, I treated you bad, I repent. Amen. Amen. Brother Branham says, only the elect of God can repent. Repentance doesn't belong to the outside world. Repentance belongs to the elect of God. Amen. It's only us that can say, we are sorry. Yeah. We can repent and rise again. Yeah. Can we say, praise the Lord? He grew up, this man grew up under wrong image. When you are wrong, face it objectively, honestly, and admit both to yourself and to your partner. Yes. Amen. I love you is absolutely necessary for every human being to be loved. No matter who the person is, we all need love. Whether you are a divorcee or a single mother, or you are a widow or a widower, every one of us, we are human beings. We come from the source of love. We want to be loved. Amen. Every person loves an appreciation. Every human being wants to be loved, to know that somebody cares for him. And many times when I came home, I see my study was clean, my wife packed my books, my cupboards was packed, my clothing was all set, the shirts was packed, my shoes was polished. It's a great blessing. And that's what a woman can can even try to please a husband. Let me go clean his study for today. Let me tell the kids to wash the car for dad. Or let me clean all his shoes. Or let me go through his cupboard and repack his shirts. Give him a surprise when he comes back home. Those small expressions can conquer many spirits in the home. Amen. Can we say praise the Lord? Amen. The expression of love is more meaningful to the woman because she is made to be loved. Amen. A man in the shipwreck of his marriage acknowledged that in 10 years he has never told his wife he loved her. When asked why, he said, "Why should I have tell her? I came to demonstrate my love to her faithfully for all these years." He said, "I bought her a new house. I bought her a new car. I gave her new carpeting. If I didn't love her, why would I have given her 5 children?" That's not love. He couldn't understand that although saying "I love you" sounded childish to him, it was meaningful to her. Can we say praise the Lord? True marriage is not based on material possessions, but it's based on true love. Can we say praise the Lord? There's many people in the country, beautiful homes, double-story homes, 2 cars, maybe have a boat, they commit suicide. The husband kills the wife, wipes the whole family out. They have everything and yet they're objects of pity. Those things doesn't bring love. Can we say praise the Lord? True marriage is not only based on material possessions, but it's based on love. Brother Branham says, "You woman, I've hollered at you, but I'm now going to take up for you a minute. The woman is the weaker vessel. I know there cannot be a bad man before there can be a bad woman. But man who knows that you are a son of God and take advantage of the woman, shame on you." No matter what she does, she is a weaker vessel, and you know that. If she goes acting unladylike, take her by the hand and talk to her like a real sister, because you are a son of God. Amen. That's why young boys should not be going around and promising young girls anything.
That's right. Amen.
The male, the boy has got a male spirit, and the female has got a female spirit. And that male spirit is transferred to her by words. And that's why I told my young people, young girls, never, never to write to a boy and tell the boy, "I love you." Never use those words, because those words are powerful words. Until you've spoken to your mom and dad, until you've gone through the process, but never, the moment you tell a boy in letter form, "I love you," you open your sanctuary. You literally open your heart, and that boy will plant his spirit right on you, and he will play with your feelings. And he will tell you, "I never meant it." And he can go from one girl to another girl, and all those girls will be possessed by that boy. Because you open your heart. I want to encourage young girls never, never to use those words to any young man. Keep those words secret until you are assured and you've gone through the processes of courtship. Amen. Hallelujah. Because we are dealing with male and female spirits. I do not believe that a married man should have conversations with young girls all the time. Because he carries a strong male spirit. And he places that male spirit upon that female spirit. Amen. The only person that you should really be friends with is your wife. And nobody else. Amen. Because you carry a male spirit upon you. And young boys should never flirt or play around with words with girls. Be sure what you are doing.
Amen.
That girl will commit suicide. She'll have a nervous breakdown. She can't forget you because she's opened her heart to you. Can we say praise the Lord? Amen. Brother Branham says, if you're the right kind of a husband, there's no woman in the world that you love like your wife. There might be other women more fair. It might be women that's more pretty and so forth. If you really love your wife, there's something in there that you don't notice what she looks like. You love her and you don't know why, but you love her. Amen. Amen. And that's why I try to encourage my young people. Don't write letters. Don't expose yourself to boys. If a boy writes you a letter, speak to your mom and dad immediately. Amen. That's your protection. You've got no protection outside of mom and dad. Yeah. You might think you can handle the situation. You cannot handle it.
Right. Amen.
That's her. Mom and dad is there to guide you through a process.
Amen.
Amen. Can we say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Brother Manham says that there's, when a woman tries to act like a man, dress like a man, and talk like a man, she's out of her place.
Amen.
That's why a woman should dress properly. Today we have, around the world, everybody wants to be like America. Every African state, everybody around. Oversized jersey, oversized trouser, oversized shoe, oversized cap. The clothing you wear carries a spirit. It literally sends messages of rebellion against. Dress decently, dress honorably. You are a daughter of Almighty God.
Amen.
The fashions of this world will pass away, but the word of God will never pass away.
Amen.
You don't have to copy Hollywood.
Amen.
You don't have to copy these movie stars. You are daughters of Almighty God. Can we say praise the Lord? Amen. A woman is feminish, sweet and loving, not big, and carry on and acting like a man. That's why even a woman's behavior before men must be important.
Yeah.
Especially young girls. Never let a boy put his jacket upon you or try to hug you or put his hand around you. Stay sane and stay sober.
Yeah.
Amen. Because everything that boy gives you carries a spirit.
Yeah.
Don't wear a chain around your neck that some boy gave you. Because on that chain, there's a spirit on that chain.
Yeah.
That boy's spirit, when you look at the chain, you look at him.
Right.
Amen.
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 You've got to know. You've got to know that we are dealing with spirits in this end time. Can we say praise the Lord? Amen. Acting like a man when she's not supposed to be. And when she does that, her life is perverted. She's got to be sweet and loving and kind. When Adam is more burly type, we was a man and masculine type. The woman was feminine, but it's the same spirit, for he took her from Adam. That's why Brother Branham said, Satan is trying to do exactly what God had in the beginning before the fall. That's why a homosexual is a man, he wants to act like a woman. But Adam had both male and female spirit in him. Before the fall.
Amen.
And when God, before the fall, God divided the spirits. Satan now wants to copy and he wants to bring the spirits back into one body.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
Be what God has made you.
Yes,
you're a woman, dress like a woman. You're a man, dress like a man.
Yes,
somebody dyes their hair brown, everybody dyes their hair brown.
Right.
Somebody dyes their hair blue, everybody dyes it blue. Some movie star comes with some cap, everybody wears it. It comes and goes, anointings. But we have something that's more permanent and more real. And that's the word of Almighty God. Amen. You notice when a man takes a wife, he takes his wife to his bosom. We're a mixed audience now. And presses this woman to his bosom as his sweetheart. She puts her print on him. Another woman there would mar it forever. They are one. No other woman should ever fit that mold. Go right with your arms around a woman, dance floor, nowhere. That's right. You've got a wife and you pull her to your bosom and God put her on your heart and printed you against her. She is yours and she belongs to you. Amen. Can we say praise the Lord? Aren't you happy, brother, sister, for the message of this hour? Amen. I thank God today. Women have a great need to be loved. As one woman said, without love, I have no life. Affection is the cement of a relationship. It unveils his feelings of his innermost. A man will never find rest until he loves the part that was taken from him.
That's good.
He will never find rest unless he loves the part that was taken from him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Just want to read a few more quotes. I trust that I'm not too long. Just a few minutes. Amen. Brother Branham comes here on page 15 of this quote that I had here. He speaks about family relationship. I might answer this right now. I don't believe in filthy living among Pentecostal people. Holiness people, even if they're married, I don't believe in that. No, sir. Some of this dirty stuff, that's so horrible. I get in here sometimes on these things, not this morning now. I ain't saying that. But what I mean on times, I'm out in California and different places like that. I meet ministers out there where on the discernment, I feel like I could turn them over my knee and give them a little gospel, protoplasma stimulation. Yes, sir. My, to see a man that would try to take his little wife and dirty, filthy. Do you understand what I mean? I think you ought to be ashamed of yourself. As a man of God, you just be a husband to your sweetheart. Respect her like you always respect her. Don't pay attention to all these sexy books that you read and all the stuff and everything like it. Get that filthy stuff out of your mind.
Amen.
Can we say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Your wife is not a sexual object. She's your love part. And Brother Branham said we should never get all this stuff in our minds. Can we say praise the Lord? And you women, live right with your husband. And you husbands, live right to your wives. Be real nice and respect one another. Just with your family relation and so forth like that. Let it be just reverently and godly and agreed among one another in everything as it can be. Don't never push and shove and be dirty and be vulgar. But be honest and decent and holy. Can we say praise the Lord? Christ is the life giver of the church. The bride is the carrier of that life. And as we submit to his word, out of his will flow his life. And out of him will flow that love. That's why he died to make us live. He was made sin to make us righteous. He became weak to make us strong. He suffered shame to give us glory. He went to hell to take us to heaven. He was condemned to justify us. He was made sick that healing might be ours. He drank the cup of death that we might drink the cup of life. He became death prisoner in order to set us free. He is our provider. He chose us. He is our protector. He loved us. He is our head, our high priest, our counselor, our prophet, our priest, our king. And his love is us. It to us is unconditional.
Amen.
Love is God unveiled.
Amen.
When a man is love rule and love own, love motivated, it does not shrink from any sacrifice. Love is the healing of every wound. Love is the heart force of life. Love is the home making force. The heart is the life of man. Life is the life of the heart. Can we say praise the Lord? Love stops the selfishness, the rust of selfishness, preserves the home and the church from decay. Love is God's adhesive power that binds us together. Love is God in action. If there is no love, there is no action. Grace is love, God in manifestation. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. Aren't you happy this morning, brother, sister? Is that your desire this morning? To love him, to love your wife just as Christ loved the church. I believe God can do it for you.
Yes.
You say, Brother Beckett, can we attain all these things? Sister Ernestine spoke, I spoke. Can we really live up to it? You can.
Yes.
It's a process.
Amen.
Don't try to do all things at one time, but take one thing at a time.
Amen.
You'll grow up as you, under the ministry of the Word of God, you'll grow up and you'll find you'll be known as you were known.
Yes.
Can we say praise the Lord? I wonder if we can all stand this morning.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I want to just maybe have a different type of altar. I want all the husbands and wives to come down to the altar, maybe down the aisles, that aisle. I want every husband and wife just to come forward. I want you to put your arm around your wife, and I want every husband to pray for one another. And the children and those in the audience, in the seats, I want you to pray. Bow your heads and pray. And we're all going to be praying for one another. I want my wife to come up as well. And I want us all as a church, as Bible believers, just to renew our vows again. Say, Lord, I want to renew my vows to my wife. I want to renew my vows to my husband. Maybe down the aisle, just be with your wife. And maybe just put your arm around your wife, or maybe hold her hand. And I want you all just to pray together. And I will pray, and you pray in your own way. And we wanted this morning to have an old-fashioned revival.
Amen.
Of renewing our vows. And don't look at the time, but just take your time. And let's just all pray together and say, God, restore our lives back again. I've made mistakes. You make mistakes. We all made mistakes. It's not how many times we fall. It's how many times we can rise again. Amen. I want us to just to pray and ask God. Let's bow our heads, and I want you to pray in your own way. Pray loud, pray soft. Whatever form you want to pray, you just pray and ask God to really just meet us. Hallelujah. Gracious Father, Lord Jesus, here we stand in your presence, O God. Lord Jesus, we come before you, Lord, as couples here, O God. Lord, as husbands and wives, we've heard over this time, oh God, our positions in the Word and our positions as wives. And Lord, this morning, Father, we want to have an old-fashioned, Lord, just old-fashioned Pentecostal restoration in our hearts. We want to pray, oh God, that you will forgive us, oh God, where we have sinned. And forgive us our trespasses, and forgive us our failures, forgive us our shortcomings, for forgive us where we have, oh God, Lord, been arrogant. Forgive us where we were rebellion, oh God. But this morning, God, as couples with our hands around one another, we want to pray sincerely that you will come, Lord, and restore our marriages. And Lord, we have our children, we have our teenagers, we have our young ones, oh God, looking at us. We are their examples, O God. And we pray this morning, may you forgive us. May you cleanse us, Father. Lord Jesus, we pray this morning, may you just come and baptize us with love. May we be lost, O God, in the sea of your love. Oh God, we pray this morning that you will just come, Lord, and meet us in a very, very special way. Lord, I thank God for my wife, and thank God that you've, Lord, given me the best, oh God. Thank you for these wonderful sisters here, Lord. Lord, you've given the best to these brothers, oh God. And we pray this morning, oh God, in this old-fashioned, Lord, of restoration again. We pray, God, may you help us. May you give us grace, oh God. May you give us mercy to be able to say, Lord, I want to try again. I want to pick up my cross. I want to restore my life. I want to, Lord, to put that honeymoon feeling back into my marriage. We pray this morning, God, for every precious dear sister here, oh God. Pray for every precious brother here this morning. Lord God, may you come, baptize us in the sea of your love, oh God. Lord, may that fountain of love just come down upon us. Lord, may you fill every heart this morning. Lord, we pray for our teenagers, oh God. Pray for, oh God, the widow sisters. We pray for those of God who are divorced or those are single parents, Lord God, may you bless them. Lord Jesus, may you draw close to them. May you become their husbands, O God. We pray, O God, may you help us. May you be with us, O God. We say, Lord, we love you. We appreciate you. We love our wives. We love our husbands. And we want to leave this camp meeting, O God, not to be the same. We're not going to try to be legalists. We're not going to try to overnight change. We're going to go, Lord, and take it one step at a time and just, Lord, slot into this great divine revelation. Hallelujah. 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 Blessed be the name of God. Blessed be His holy name. While we stand, while we raise our hands, let's sing a little song. Father, make us one. Father, make us one. That the world may know thou hast sent thy Son. Father, make us one. Father, make us one. Father, make us one. That the world may know thou hast sent thy Son. Oh, Father, make us one. Father, make us one. Father, make us one. Father, make us one. That the world may know thou hast sent thy Son. O Father, make us one. Let's sing it one more time. Father, make us one. While Brother Jeff comes up, Father, make us one. Father, make us one. That the world may know, that the world may know, thou hast sent thy Son. Oh, Father, make us one. Amen. God bless you. One of you can just hug your wife and say, honey, I really love you and appreciate you. Amen. Could we do that? Can we just hug your wife and say, honey, I really love you and I appreciate you. God bless you. God bless you, Brother Jeff. God bless you.
I'll let you be seated. We have a few things we want to do here. I just was so touched and so moved by this morning. I was thinking while I was sitting there, I don't know where I'd be. I've always kind of been pretty careful with my finances, but I was thinking of my father-in-law. I appreciate my father-in-law.
Amen.
Appreciate the teaching he's brought this assembly, this camp, these 4 years. On finances.
Amen.
He says, Jeff, he says, can I preach on something else? Everybody's going to think I'm the finance minister. And of course, I told him I want him. He's got, and those of my congregation knows he can preach something else. But his gift, you know, everybody has a gift. His gift is faith. And I want, and it takes faith to operate the way he does in the realm of finances. Also takes faith to operate the way he does in the realm of healing. He said people have come up to him and said, given him this remedy and that remedy for the Bell's palsy that he has. He says, God is my remedy.
Amen.
Now, he doesn't want to mix his faith with anything else. Now, some of you out there can say, well, I have no problem with that. I can take herbs or I can use some form of stimulation and I can do something to help aid my healing. That's your faith. And he honors, I honor, we would all honor your faith. But his faith is to look to God and God alone. Then we'll honor that faith. His gift is faith. His gift is faith. So I've told him, next year, if there's another year, I want the camp people to experience faith preaching. We want to dedicate some of the services to the youth. Another person I was thinking of, my father-in-law, another person I was thinking of is Brother Barry. Brother Barry is not only a dear friend of mine, but he's so understanding and flexible. He'll move in and out. He'll do whatever he can do. If he doesn't have to do anything, praise God, he's going to come and enjoy the word. If he can help in every service, praise the Lord, I'll help in every service. If I can help with the youth, clean the grounds, he's just such a blessing. And I appreciate Brother Barry Coffey and the blessing he's brought to this camp as well. And then I also want to, in appreciating my father and my mother-in-law, I want to appreciate them and thank them for giving to me their daughter. Thank you, Brother Cobb, Sister Rachel, for your daughter. I was telling some people the other day, I said, you know, my wife always says, what would happen if I died? You'd marry some girl 20 years younger. And I say, honey, it's taken 14 years for us to become this one. Why would I want to start all over again? You don't become one on your honeymoon night. That's just bodily one. It takes years to understand one another and to become one. Brother Dallas Covey was telling us how one they become. He says, I don't even talk to my wife anymore. He says, we're so one, I just think it, and she knows what I'm saying. She says, honey, I'll tell you what, I'll just stop talking. Now, how many knows Brother Dallas can't stop talking? But honey, I'll just stop talking, and you just listen. How many believe we can have the mind of Christ like that? How many know we know the mind of Christ? But you know that with your mate, don't you? You can stop and you can say, I know what you're thinking. I know what you're thinking. You know one another that well. Well, that's because we know the mind of our mate. How many know the mind of your mate, Jesus Christ? Amen. Amen. So many wonderful things. But I want to thank my dad-in-law and my mom-in-law for what they've given to me. I'll tell you how much I love my mom and my dad-in-law. We spent 13 vacations together. For 15 days at a time, most of that in the same cabin by a river. And we thoroughly, thoroughly enjoy one another's fellowship. See, when you marry a woman, teenagers, you don't just marry that woman. You marry the whole family. It's a family affair. You marry that mother-in-law, that father-in-law, the aunts, the uncles, the brothers, the sisters. You marry the relatives, so be careful how you treat that girl. Amen. You don't just marry that one person. You marry the whole family. And it's so wonderful. It's so wonderful to have that sort of harmony with a mom and dad-in-law as well. And I just want to thank my wife, Debbie, for selflessly, single-handedly, taking care of the kids the entire week of camp while I take care of camp affairs. I appreciate her so much and her help. She's a beaver. She's a sanguine with a little bit of caloric, Brother Harold. And maybe caloric with a little bit of sanguine. I don't know. But she's a beaver. She's a go, go, go person. She gets things done. She's the organizer. She's the list person. Everything that a woman isn't, a man is. Because the feminine was taken out. And everything that a man isn't, a woman is. Now, they can either use that difference to compete or to complement. But if you'll ever realize it, that it should be complementary. As I've said to my assembly 100 times, and I'll say it tonight, and I've said it here before, the crowning act of creation was not Adam. the crowning act of creation, listen to me, was not Eve. You say, well, she was created last. She came out of Adam. She was the last creation out of Adam. Wasn't she the crowning act of creation? No, really, the crowning act of creation was when God brought Eve back to Adam and they became one. That was a creative act. And that's what God's want. God is still creating. As we become one with him and he one with us, that's a creative act. God is forming himself into bride form. So what God wants, and as Brother Harold ended with St. John 17, that the world might know that there's a God, that he's real, they'll know it by our love for one another. They'll know it. The world will know it. Your children will know it. The people in the restaurant seeing you together as a family unit will know it. By your love one for another. And as they see it in the church body. Brother Bram said when the church is happy, the pastor's happy, God is happy. That has more often than what the preacher says when that sinner comes off the street. It's what that sinner sees in the way of the harmony between the minister and the people, the response to God, the worship, the oneness, the sense. See, we don't realize it, but to a sinner, we seem so innocent and so pure because we haven't been hardened and defiled by the world. And they want that innocency, and they want that purity, and they sense it all about you. See, you don't realize how much you emanate with the presence of God. You emanate so much with the presence of God. There's such a glow about God's bride. See, you came from another dimension, were put in a temporal body, but you are nonetheless the ambassadors of God, sent from a foreign land to this country to bring life and light to as many as will receive you. Amen. Praise God. And the fourth person I'd like to acknowledge is my dad. He is my foundation. He is the solid undergirding that gives me strength, that gave me life, and gives me courage every day of my life. He is a man of faith. I've often thought, I'm sure many of you have thought, what am I going to do when my mom or my dad pass away? He is such a part of my life. And I'm such a part of his life. Whether he has one service in the camp, no services in the camp. This morning he comes by knocking on the door. He says, hey, if you don't have enough, you only got one shower in there. If you need our showers. Jeff, have you eaten yet? No, I haven't eaten yet. Came back with a whole tray of food for me. Just whatever he can do. And that's his life. He is a servant. He is a servant. And early on, he learned that God, that his motto is, God is in control. Amen. And I'll say this to encourage some of you young ministers. He sat at Brother Perry's church, Tucson Tabernacle, with a gift, traveling around the world, going to Pakistan predominantly and India, missionary on the missionary field. Did his work. He had his own company in landscaping. He worked 9 months out of the year, used the money that he'd saved in the profits in landscaping, and then go buy a brother a Jeep or go overseas and preach the gospel, then have to use his own funds to bring all the ministers in to be able to tell them because no church was supporting him. And he did that with, he never even considered support. He was doing it because they needed to hear the gospel. For 12 years, he was never preached in the church. People would come up to him, ministers would come and go that never got recognized, and they'd say, how can you stand it? I don't understand why you've never preached in this church with your gift and the ministry you have. And he'd say, Brother Perry's not God. God's God.
Amen.
And if God wants me to speak, he'll speak to Brother Perry.
That's right.
And Brother Perry will have me speak. I will speak when God wants me to speak, and until then, I don't want to speak.
Amen.
So it wasn't Perry Green, and I don't want you to, I want you to understand that.
Right.
God was leading Brother Perry as to when the time would be. Your pastor will know when you're ready.
Amen.
You get ahead of your pastor, you get ahead of God.
That's good.
Your pastor knows when you're ready, young minister. He knows what you need when you need it. Because God's going to use that headship to help you and guide you. 12 years. He was preaching up in Onion Lake, up in Canada. Brother Perry happened to be there. And he heard Brother Lonnie speak. His pastor heard him speak for the first time. He says, I don't believe it. We've been missing out on this gift all these years. Had no idea under his roof. Well, he was, Brother Lonnie was just a landscaper, made some money, went overseas, preached the gospel. Come back and ended up ministering up in Onion Lake. And that was when God began to open his doors. And they've never shut since. And when God shuts them, he'll be just as happy as the day they shut as the day they were open.
Amen.
God's in control. I learned that. I learned that when we were driving down the road in an old motorhome that somebody let us use, the church let us use, and we had no money left. And Brother Cobb, forgive me, but we'd have to use the credit card. And we put it on the credit card, and people, we would go to churches and preach. Everybody thought we were financially supported by the home church. So even the offerings were small. And so we subsisted for 5 years. But did you know that we never had to leave a lingering debt on that credit card? God every time paid our bills.
Amen.
Ministers would say, here's some money, Brother Lonnie, to go overseas and preach the gospel, but I want you to pay me back when we get home. Okay. I said, Dad, how are you going to pay that back? You don't have any money. God will supply. We'd get home, and a brother would say, Brother Lonnie, I've got an old Volkswagen I don't need. I noticed you gave your car away. How about you take my old Volkswagen? My dad sell the Volkswagen, use the money to pay the plane tickets. He would give everything away so often that my grandfather, his dad, gave him his old 1964 Buick Wildcat. He said, now, son, I'm giving you this Wildcat, but if you ever decide to give it away, you have to give it back to me. Because he knew how his son was. So I want to thank my dad. Thank my dad-in-law. Thank Brother Barry, Sister Becky. Thank my wife.
Amen.
And lastly, I want to thank the staff, and that's where Brother Steve comes in. Are you ready, Brother Steve? Amen. Why don't you come, Brother Steve? And I think, Brother Steve, we owe him a round of applause for everything he has done. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Message of love that was brought out here.
Amen.
Because Jeff kind of gave me a little prelude to all this last night, and on a 3x5, actually it was verbal, what he wanted me to do. So I'm hoping that what I've got put together here, and don't worry, I'm not a preacher, so I won't be too long. But I just wanted to say a few things concerning the staff. And I wonder if you would first, let's turn to Galatians chapter 6. I'm just going to read two verses. It's Galatians 6. And we're going to start with verse 9. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap, if we faint not. As we have, therefore, opportunity, as we have had this week, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith.
Amen. Amen.
That's been kind of the guiding theme among these four camps that we've held so far, and by the grace of God, we'll have a fifth. But that's our desire. I told Jeff it's sort of like when a woman has a baby. Right afterwards, she says, never again, you know. But maybe a few months later, you know, she becomes pregnant again, and all of a sudden, they start looking forward to that next arrival. And that's sort of the way it is with these camps. If you ask most of the staff right now, they're probably saying, never again. But I'll guarantee you, by next spring, the thoughts will start rolling again. We've got to get ready for camp. You know, our master was weary when he went to the cross. He was weary and well-doing. But he fainted not, but he persevered to the end. What I'd like to do is I'd like to call all the staff that has worked, all the husbands, all the wives, all the teenagers, all the young people that put some labor in. I'd like them to come up to the front right now and stand and look out on the rest of the congregation. So if you would do that quickly, please, I'd appreciate it. And as they come forward, we said that Jesus fainted not, but persevered. And he became weary and well-doing. And you know, I see a lot of little Jesuses here.
Amen.
This is the bride of Christ working for others in the bride of Christ. You know, I work for a very large corporation. And in the natural, one thing I've learned is that successful companies have one thing in common. They have a team that pulls together, working toward the ultimate goal of total customer satisfaction. That's what makes a company successful. This group here is the greatest team I've ever seen, and I've worked with some good ones. They have worked unselfishly for those who come here to be fed the gospel, for fellowship, for all those things. We've tried to provide an atmosphere that would give that to those of you who have come here. And I know there's many who are missing now that had to go back last night, and I wish they could get their praise also. But this is for you. These people have done this for you, and I'm so proud of them. As the coordinator of the camp, I've had the easy job because I've empowered them in the natural. I've let every department head run their own department the way they wanted to. I didn't try to dictate what they do. They know how best to run their own departments. They got the mechanics done, what was required. But he has empowered them in the spirit. The dynamics that we've seen this week is apparent to all. We've laid a good foundation here to get ready, but the dynamics has come upon it, and we have seen this, but it's a lot in large part because of the dedicated labor that is right here. And I'd like for those, I'm going to name off each individual group because I want each one to be recognized. I want you to raise your hands what group you worked with. Those who labored so long, so many hours, and so hard in the kitchen, I'd like them to all raise their hands.
Raise them all.
Give them a hand. I'd like all those who worked with the Bible school kids to teach them the things of God and to do the crafts and all those things and look after your kids while you were in here, the parents were in here listening to the word. I would like them to raise their hands. All the deacons and the trustees who have been working around the camp to keep things in order and to look after people's needs and just be there for whoever needed them for whatever reason, would they please raise their hands? And sometimes the most underappreciated group is the custodial staff, but let me tell you, if they didn't do their job, you would know it. So let's all have the custodial staff raise their hands. Next, those who have such chaos around them, especially as camp opens and at different points in time when people are coming in by the droves to register. I'd like to recognize those who work the registration desk. There's also those who have the job of shuttling people back and forth to motels and to airports and all those types of jobs. Brother Barney, you didn't come up, but I see you back there, and I know you participated in this. And there's others here, Brother Gary Holsapple. I'm not sure if they're all here, but let's give them a round of applause also. You're starting to see it takes a big team to do all this, doesn't it? A lot of areas. I'm only a third of the way through. Let's recognize those who work in the snack bar. They stand out there for long hours on their feet and hands sticky and all sorts of things like that, you know, and things you don't think about. Let's give them a round of applause. I'd also like to recognize Brother Nate Ball and his son John, who made a lot of the signs like you see around the grounds here and that beautiful missionary display out there. Let's give them a round of applause. Next is the musicians. I don't know about you, but they've certainly been a blessing to me. Next, I'd like to recognize all those involved with activities, taking the kids off and having group sessions with them and playing Red Rover and volleyball games and basketball games and all the things they've been doing this week. And I'm really thrilled when I see young men in their early 20s working with the little bitty kids. It really gets you, you know, to see them be willing to do that. So let's give them a round of applause. Next is a group that's kind of near and dear to me, and that's the books and tape sales people. And this year, I kind of in the last three camps, I've kind of been the one to kind of direct that. But this year, I decided I was just going to turn them loose, and I let my wife be the department head. And as usual, my wife has come through for me 100%. And I like to recognize the book and tape sales people. Next is the group who probably gets the least sleep of anybody in the whole camp. And that would be the counselors who are in the dorms till 2 o'clock. And I don't know how we're going to do this, Brother Franco, but we want to get a picture of the your crew. And I don't know how we're going to accomplish that, but let's hear it for all those who put in a lot of hours doing this. Also, I'd like to recognize Chris back there on the sound, who's been with us for a couple years now. Next, that one that's there when you're hurting. Let's hear it for the nurses. I'd also like to recognize, there's a few around and I'm not sure where they all are. They're probably not a part of our group, actually. But I would like to recognize those who have done the translations. Brother Anton and I think Brother Fernando and some have helped us with the translation. also a couple other people that have kind of been behind the scenes. You haven't seen is Brother Rod Weingartner, who has provided a semi-truck for us to haul equipment back and forth in. Certainly made it better than 15 cars and trucks full of stuff. When you can put it all in one big semi at one time and make it down here, it really is a benefit. And also Brother Chris Semrock, who encouraged his company to provide the big dumpster for us out there to haul the trash in this year. Now, if I've missed anybody, I really apologize. I really racked my brain to try and think of every group. I'm certain I may have neglected someone. I did not do that intentionally. I tried to recognize everybody that helped. And last but not least, I would like to recognize one last group, and they were the ones whose dedication helped provide the dynamics, and that is the ministry. Those who sought the Lord for the will of God for this camp. Brother Lonnie, Brother Brown, Brother Cobb, Brother Coffey, Brother Beckett, Brother Jeff, especially Brother Jeff, whose vision to have a camp like this was a seed that was planted. Here's the hard part. It was a seed planted, and it's now grown into a beautiful bouquet of love.
Let's give Jesus a standing ovation.
And the word our Lord has given. Isn't the Lord wonderful? When Brother Harold was talking about using that term, I love you, I remember as a very young man when I first began to be attracted to girls, and my daddy gave me a good bit of wisdom. He said, son, he says, don't you ever tell a girl, I love you, unless you're ready for the next words to be, will you marry me? He says, don't say it until those two things are going to go together. Yeah, I think that's good leadership. So glad for what God's done, God's doing. Let's stand, if you would. Talk to the one who really made it all possible. Heavenly Father, we love you so much, so very much. And God, you are the great coordinator. We do things the best that we can, but God, if your touch is not on it, the blessing just isn't there. I think of this scripture in the Bible where Moses' father-in-law, Jethro, came and advised Moses to divide up the load, and he thought it was good advice, and he got 70 men, and he tried to divide up the load, and we find just in the very next chapter that Moses is still complaining, my burden is too great. And so God says, okay, I'll tell you what to do. Pick out 70 men. Exactly the same thing the father-in-law said. He says, but then God took the spirit of Moses and put it on the 70. Jethro couldn't do that. Only God could do that. So it took that touch of God to put the final blessing on the very same thing that natural advice had devised, but without the touch of God. And so, Lord, in every area of our life as we leave this place, we need that touch, Lord. We've heard good leadership. We've heard good words. And they're all wonderful. But until the Spirit comes to the Word, we're dumb sheep, Lord. We just can't do it by ourselves. So, God, we commit the Word that has been planted in our hearts to you to help us to water it and bring it forth, nurture it into our lives and our marriages. And the young unmarrieds that have been here listening to all this, I hope that much of it could sink in, that it would help channel them for not only choosing a mate, but how to conduct themselves in marriage. Keep the saints safe, Lord, as you drive home along the way, and all those that came forward that shared in the work in the camp, Lord, may they recuperate quickly. We have much more cleanup yet to do, and God, thank you for all that you've done. Thank you, Lord, and may your blessings be on those as they travel home. Keep them safe. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. We'll meet you out by the pool. If you see any trash, any litter on the ground, pick it up and put it in a trash bin. That'll make it a lot easier on the staff. We'd appreciate that. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. God bless you. We'll see you out by the water.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Cleansed by his blood, joint heirs with Jesus as we travel. Travel this up, for I'm But that I